Then the next technique used in the advanced microprocessor in order to increase the execution speed is known as branch prediction. So from the name itself, you will get some idea. It is used for predicting different branches of execution based on a condition. You are trying to predict a particular branch based on the condition. So in the case of a pipelined normal or ideal pipelined processor, generally the cycles per instruction will be one. We have in one of the slides we have seen that. But due to the branch misprediction penalty, if we are predicting a branch which was not correct, what will happen? Again, the pipeline should be flushed out, new pipeline should be filled in, which will create increase of cycles per instructions. Because for in one instruction, more cycles will be taken if the branch prediction was wrong. That is known as branch prediction penalty, right? And when the pipelines are getting more and more deeper, the resolution of the branches will be only performed in a later stage of the pipeline, right? We have seen deep pipelines. So if you are having deep pipelines, the branch prediction will be taking place only in a later stage. So what is the problem with that? Again, in that stage, if the branch prediction penalty is occurring or misprediction penalty is occurring, or if the branch prediction was wrong, what will happen? The pipeline should be flushed out because all the instructions issued after the mispredicted branch should be flushed out. It will increase the CPI. So to address this problem, most of the pipeline processors will be using a technique known as branch predictor, which is used for branch prediction. And some of the branches you can see that it will be taken only at the end of the loop and branches back to the repeat of the loop. For example, if you are having a while loop or say for loop, you'll be executing a particular loop, say 10 or 15 times. We'll keep on executing that. And at the end, what will happen? Once the loop has been executed one time, say if you have written for I equal to or I less than 50, I equal to 0, I less than 15, that loop is specified or designed to execute 15 times. So once the loop has been executed, what will be the last checking done? You will check whether the variable is less than 15. If it is less than 15, again, you need to go back to the first statement of the loop. You need to repeat the loop. So the branching will be checked as the last statement, or the branching will happen at end of each loop. Right. Whenever one loop is over, you will check. When the condition is true, you will keep on executing the loop. Otherwise, you will branch out of the loop. So the simplest form of branch prediction was, what they have done was, what was that? They will be checking the direction of the branch, right? And predict that backward branches only should be taken. So in the case of for loop and while loop, when one loop is over, then only the checking will be done. If the checking is right, you need to go back. The direction is going back. So the simplest method of branch prediction is, will be checking for the direction of the branch, and it will predict that the branch should be taken only if it is a backward direction branch. So branch will be taken if the direction of the branch is backward, that is from last line to the first line of the loop, right? So this kind of branch prediction is known as static branch prediction. So you have already written there, if the direction of the branch is backward, you can predict it as that branch is correct, or predict that backward branch only should be taken. That is known as static branch prediction. Why it is known as static? Because it is not dependent upon the history of the program. It is not at all dependent upon the history, because it is statically defined. If the direction is backward, you can take that branch. But that is not always true. This cannot be implemented in all the conditions. So they have developed something known as dynamic branch prediction. dynamic branch prediction. So in the dynamic branch prediction, dynamic branch prediction will be available only for the forward branches. Generally, it will be applicable for the forward branches. Why? Because forward branches are difficult to predict without the knowledge of the program. Right, you need to check certain condition. If that condition is true, then only you should branch to one location. Otherwise, you need to branch to a different location. So you need to have track of the program execution or history of the program. Right. So therefore, most of the process use dynamic branch predictors. Why? Because it will use the history of the program to guess whether a branch should be taken or not taken. So dynamic branch prediction depends upon the history of the program. Right. How it is keeping track of the history of the program? It will maintain a table, as you have seen in the register naming. So the dynamic branch predictors will maintain a table of certain hundreds or thousands of instruction, that is branch instruction, that the processor has executed. It will maintain a table of the previous branching that has been done. That table is known as branch target buffer. What does it include? It contains destination of the branch and history of the branch, whether it was taken or not. It includes the destination of the branch and the history of the branch, whether the branch was taken or not. Now we will deal with two types of dynamic branch prediction methods known as 1-bit branch prediction and 2-bit branch prediction. So for explaining this 1-bit and 2-bit branch prediction, we are taking an example of a for loop. So for I equal to 0, I less than 5, I plus plus, and it is having one statement A equal to A plus 1. So this loop will be incrementing from I equal to 0 to I equal to 4. That means the inner function will be executing 5 times. So whenever we are dealing with a for loop, it will be considered as a branch instruction inside a processor. Right. So it is having two branches possible here. If the branch is taken, then it will go inside the for loop and execute this function. If the branch is not taken, it will go outside the for loop, and whatever instruction is given after the for loop will be executed. So two possible branches is there. If the branch is taken, it will go inside the for loop. If branch is not taken, it will go outside the for loop. Right. So this is a example what you are going to see. So first of all, let us see 1-bit branch predictor. So in the 1-bit branch predictor, there are two states available. Those states are represented by 0 and 1 because it is a 1-bit branch predictor. And the 0th state is nothing but not taken state. 1 state is taken state. So the 1 state or taken state always predicts that the branch should be taken. And the 0 stage, that is a not taken stage, always predicts that branch should not be taken. So NT stands for not taken. So 1 state predicts that branch should be taken. 0 state predicts that branch should not be taken. So for this example of the for loop, let us consider that initially this for loop is in state 1, that is taken state. So when I equal to 0, I is compared if it is less than 5. So it is less than 5. So this state predicts that branch should be taken. Because it is a taken state, so it will predict that branch should be taken. So I am writing when I equal to 0 in 1-bit branch prediction, I am predicting it as taken. So that is right. So branch should be taken and the execution should go inside the for loop and execute whatever it is written there. Then I will be incremented to 1. Again, that will be checked whether it is less than 5. So it is less than 5. So it is still in taken state. So what will happen? It will predict that branch should be taken. So when I equal to 1, again branch should be taken is predicted. So like this,
whenever the I is incrementing till I equal to 4, the taken state will predict that branch should be taken. So till I equal to 4, the prediction will be correct. But when I equal to 5, what will happen to this condition? When I equal to 5, the condition will be wrong. That is, I less than 5 condition will be wrong. But still, since our for loop is in taken state, even though I equal to 5, it will again predict that branch should be taken. So when I equal to 5, again it will predict that branch should be taken. But this prediction is wrong. So this is known as a misprediction. Because when I equal to 5, branch should not be taken. So the branching should go out of the for loop. But according to this state diagram, it will predict that it should be taken. So that is a misprediction. That is why I have written in red color taken. So this branch should be taken. That is wrong. So it is a mispredicted value. And actually what should happen? Branch should not be taken. So from this state, when the branch is not taken, the for loop will move from first this taken state to not taken state. So from this state, the for loop has taken the not taken path, and now it is available, it is present in the not taken state. So one misprediction was there. Then after some time, if the same for loop is getting executed somewhere else in the program, what will happen? Now we know that the for loop is in the not taken state in the previous ending loop or the last loop. So when again this for loop is getting executed somewhere in the program, for loop is still here. So when I equal to 0 and I is less than 5, what will happen? For the first loop, it will predict that branch should not be taken. Since the for loop is in not taken state, and when I equal to 0, it will predict that branch should not be taken. So it is predicting that branch should not be taken. But this also is wrong. This also is a mispredicted value. So again, misprediction has happened. Because when I equal to 0, I is less than 5, so branch should be taken actually, and branch should be taken and it should go inside the loop. But according to my state diagram, it has predicted that branch should not be taken. So the second time my branch misprediction has occurred, and actually the branch should be taken. So the for loop will move from not taken state to taken states. Why? Because the branch should be taken actually. Since the branch should be taken, it will change the state from not taken to taken state. So now for loop has reached in the taken state, and when I equal to 1, I is less than 5, and since the for loop is in taken state, it will predict that it will be taken. So this will go on till I equal to 4. So here what you have identified in the 1-bit branch prediction, two mispredictions has occurred. One mispredication has occurred in the ending of the loop. Second misprediction has occurred at the next starting of the loop. Whenever the for loop is executed again, first time when it is executed, one mispredication has occurred. And in the previous loop, in the last loop, misprediction has occurred. So total two mispredictions occurred in the case of 1-bit branch predictor. This 1-bit branch predictor mispredicts the first and last branches of the loop. In order to overcome this disadvantage, we are going for 2-bit branch predictor. So in the 2-bit branch predictors, 4 states will be there. So 00 is represented as strongly not taken. 01 is represented as weakly not taken. 10 is represented as weakly taken. 11 is represented as strongly taken. So 4 states are there since it is 2-bit branch predictor. And we are considering the same for loop example. And initially, we are considering that for loop is in this state. Say, let us take strongly taken state. You can consider either of this state. For time being, I am taking this state. So, the for loop is in this state. So, what will happen? When I equal to 0, I is less than 5. So, since it is strongly taken state, it will predict that branch should be taken. Since it is strongly taken state, it predicts that branch should be taken. And it is correct actually, since I equal to 0, I less than 5, branch should be taken and it should go inside the loop. So when I equal to 0 in 2-bit branch predictor, branch should be taken, was predicted it is 2. Then when I equal to, I was incremented to 1, again I is less than 5. So again, since it is in strongly taken state, it will predict that branch should be taken. So since I equal to 1, it is less than 5, again the prediction was true. So this will keep on continuing until I equal to 4. When I equal to 4, again this state will predict that branch should be taken, it is correct. And actually it was correct because I equal to 4, I is less than 5. But when I is reaching 5 and still for loop is in strongly taken state, it will again predict that branch should be taken. Since I is equal to 5 and for loop is in 1-1 state, it will again predict that the branch should be taken. But actually it is wrong according to the program. Because when I equal to 5, I is not less than 5, the condition is false. When I equal to 5, I is not less than 5. So actually this branch should not be taken, it should go outside the for loop, that it should follow the not taken path. But since for loop is in strongly taken state, it is predicting that branch should be taken, but that is wrong. So one, the first misprediction occurred here. So at the end of the loop, the for loop, first misprediction has occurred. So it has predicted that branch should be taken, but according to the condition, branch was not taken, should not be taken. So from the strongly taken state, since the branch is not taken, for loop will move on to weakly taken state. From the strongly taken state, since the branch is not taken, it will go to weakly taken state. So now for loop is in weakly taken state. And after some execution of some lines of the program, if this for loop is again getting executed, where will be the for loop? For loop will be in the weakly taken state. Because in the previous last statement, we have moved from strongly taken to weakly taken. So presently, the for loop will be in weakly taken state if it is executing somewhere else in the program. So initially I equal to 0, so and since it is in weakly taken state, it will predict that branch should be taken. When I equal to 0, branch should be taken. But it is correct because I equal to 0, I is less than 5, so actually branch should be taken. Right? So it will move from weakly taken to strongly taken state. So when I equal to 0, branch should be taken was predicted. It is actually correct. Then it will move from weakly taken to strongly taken state, and in strongly taken state I will be incremented to 1. Right? Since it is in strongly taken state, it will again predict that branch should be taken. So when I equal to 1, it is predicting that branch should be taken. That is also correct. So this will keep on continuing until I equal to 4. So here in branch predictor, in the 2-bit branch predictor, you need to keep in mind only one misprediction has occurred. The one misprediction has occurred only at the last branch of the loop. In the case of 1-bit branch predictor, there was two branch mispredictions occurred. One was in the ending of the loop, that is last branch of the loop. Other was on the first branch of the loop. Using 2-bit branch predictor, you are able to reduce the number of mispredictions from 2 mispredictions to 1 misprediction. Because in 2-bit branch predictor, only one misprediction will be occurring at the last branch of the loop. So this is the advantage of 2-bit branch predictor.